This is WKTV Journal. In focus today is Aric Nesbitt, who is running in the Republican primary for the 26th State Senate District, which includes the city of Kentwood. Nesbitt describes himself as a public servant, having served three terms as a state representative before, most recently, as a member of Governor Rick Snyder's cabinet, serving as lottery commissioner. He earned a BA in economics from Hillsdale College and a master's in international business from Norwegian School of Economics. He lives near Lawton with his wife, Trisha, down the road from his family's farm. Thank you for being with us today.
Thanks, Ken. Thanks for having me.
So we've talked previously as you're running for this seat that one of the first things on your priority list is to defend Michigan's economic comeback. Yeah. And you were part of the State House when Governor Snyder first came to office. What policies of the governor and the Republican majority led to this comeback, and why does it need defending?
Yeah, so you look at the 26 Senate districts, all of Van Buren County, Allegan County, Gaines, and Kentwood here in Kent County. And we're fortunate to live in West Michigan. We have a great area, beautiful area, great quality of life. And I'm from a sixth generation dairy and grape farm down in Van Buren County. And so I'm trying to get a little better known here in Kentwood and in Gaines Township here in Kent County. But in 2010, when I ran for the State House, I ran because I was tired of waving goodbye to my generation. I was tired of waving, every 13 minutes there was another family that was leaving the state. We had double digit unemployment. I think it was 14.7% unemployment. And so we had $1.5 billion deficit. We lost hundreds of thousands of manufacturing jobs in the state of Michigan. Mm-hmm. Economy was collapsing all the way around us. And so I decided to step up and I ran for the State House in 2010. And I served 6 years in the State House. I worked with Governor Snyder to balance budgets, pay down debt, repeal the old Michigan business tax, concentrate on getting the economy going again. We moved from, dead last in our business tax here in the state to one of the top 10 states for attracting business here in Michigan. We've eliminated about 2,300 burdensome rules and regulations that we systematically went through and undid some of these burdensome rules and regulations that prevented our economy from growing. And we've seen the effect of these reforms, passing budgets on time, passing them balanced. You don't hear about that on the news anymore. Because when you don't get it done by your deadline, you hear about it on the news. Mm-hmm. When you get it done 4 months early and you're paid down about $20 billion of long-term debt here in the state, it's not newsworthy in a lot of places, except maybe your show, Ken. And so over the last 8 years, we've seen from these reforms, we've seen over 550,000 new private sector jobs created here in Michigan. That's exciting. People are starting to come back. We're starting to feel that recovery, but we're not done yet. There's a lot more work to do. And I think as you look at it, you need to, what I hear is out there is cost of living issues, such as the cost of auto insurance. Mm-hmm. Too expensive. We need to do a reform on the way we do auto insurance. Rebuilding our roads. I think that's a very important issue. There's a roads package that we are investing more in roads, but after 30 years of decay here in the state and disinvestment, that's going to take a while for us to rebuild them, but we need to double our efforts to rebuild our roads and bridges. And then also continue paying down our long-term debt here in the state. If we continue on the progress we've made the last 8 years in paying down our long-term debt, Michigan will be debt-free by 2038. Now that seems like a long time, 20 years, mm-hmm. but that's shorter than a 30-year mortgage. And I think that that's something that, as we look at it, that's part of the reason why I'm running, is for my children and grandchildren so that they can inherit a state here in Michigan where the state government doesn't owe any debt. And I think that'd be a huge factor as we look at prioritizing our spending and being able to do, cut taxes and reinvest in our roads infrastructure.
Okay, that brings up to where I wanted to go to drill down a little bit. You have said that you want to, quote, double down on rebuilding our roads, but also paying long-term debt. Can the state pay more and still pay down its debt? Where's that money going to come from?
Oh, absolutely. The state has a $57 billion budget. And right now we're putting, this year, it'll be about $4.2 billion that'll be put into the roads. Okay. Now that's up from 4 years ago, from that was traditionally $3.5 billion. Mm-hmm. And through this plan, we can continue to grow that to $4.7 billion, but it's more in terms of roads and bridges. You know, from the growth in the general fund budget, we can continue to double down in terms of growth. We've been prioritizing our state, in terms of paying down our debt. That's just continuing doing what we're doing. We'll be debt free by 2038. Mm-hmm. If you double down on payments, you always get out of debt a little early also. Mm-hmm. But I do think that rebuilding our roads aren't getting any cheaper either. So I think we need to continue to make that a priority. I've always considered when I'm doing budgeting that the three main priorities in our budget are roads and bridges, our schools, and then also our law enforcement, making sure we're protected and we're safe. And so that's something that I'm going to continue to work on. I think we've made some progress on.
Okay. You just touched on it. What would be some of your other priorities? Should you be elected? Where are some places where the public should expect you to work?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of areas that need work on. I talked about the budget, mm-hmm. paying down debt, passing balanced budgets, continuing to make sure that we limit government so that we prioritize our spending. Banning these so-called sanctuary cities so local law enforcement work with federal law enforcement. I think that's a fairly common sense issue that we can work on. And then there's a lot of other areas such as the opioid epidemic, the meth epidemic mm-hmm. that's out there, really protecting our families. And I'm a law and order type of Republican, but we also need to have pathways to prevent people from going into that, life of crime or self-destruction that's there. And so that's an area that we've seen a growth of and that we need to continue to combat.
Okay, you bring up sanctuary cities. What are, at this point, what are Michigan's sanctuary cities? Why are those a bad thing? And is that not an example of local control? If a city wants to be a sanctuary city?
I think it's pretty common sense that local law enforcement should work with state law enforcement and federal law enforcement. This is something that's called communication between the different levels of government, and I think it's fairly common sense. Lansing debated about becoming a sanctuary city last year. Fortunately, they did not. You could say that certain aspects that, Detroit's made some movements at times, Ann Arbor has. I mean, and you look at other states like Illinois has become a sanctuary state mm-hmm. Or California. And I think this is something that if we have laws, if we're a nation of laws, that our laws need to be followed and our law enforcement need to be able to communicate whether they're local, county, state, or federal law enforcement. This is how tragedies happen is if they're not communicating together.
Very good. You have stated, and I've read before, that you that Lansing needs conservative West Michigan values. Mm-hmm. And that brings up two questions. One, is the state government, which is now controlled by the Republican Party, is the Republican Party and its leadership not conservative enough for you at this point?
Well, I think as you look, we've made a lot of progress over the last 8 years. Okay. We've cut about 2,300 different burdensome rules and regulations. We've moved from having a rainy day fund of about $2 million to about $1 billion in rainy day fund. We've mm-hmm. paid down about $20 billion of long-term debt. Mm-hmm. But there has been some areas where I've disagreed with some of the majority in Lansing, mm-hmm. such as expansion of Obamacare here in the state that happened 4 years ago. I opposed that and stood up on that. A few years ago when they passed a $2 billion tax increase that was defeated at the polls, it was like lemmings in the state capitol. There was, I think, 96 out of 110 members of the state house voted for it. I was one of, I think, about 14 or 15 that voted against that proposal and putting it on the ballot because it was a $2 billion tax increase, but only $1.2 billion was going to be going for roads. I didn't think that passed the smell test. So there are areas where I think we do need to continue to work on. We've made a lot of progress, but it was something where I introduced a bill 3 years ago that would phase out the income tax over the coming years. Mm-hmm. That didn't get a hearing, that didn't get up to vote. That's something where I'd want to continue to work on is lowering the state's income tax. And then also there are a lot of other factors in terms of actually trying to constrain our state government and spending and where our priorities are.
Okay, very good. Let's talk about term limits for as we wrap up this interview. You were state representative served three terms, were term limited out. But you probably would not have had the opportunity to run for state senate in this district without term limits as well. So is term limits doing what it was designed to do to create movement within state government?
Yeah, I mean, and I wouldn't have had the opportunity probably in 2010 to run for the state house if it wasn't for term limits either. Mm-hmm. And I look at what we did in 2011 after we, after eight, the lost decade here in Michigan, mm-hmm. of 10 years in the lost decade, that the new crop of folks, there was about 2/3 of the state house that was new, 3/4 of the state senate that was new, a new governor, a new lieutenant governor, new secretary of state, new attorney general, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And I think the actions that we took in 2011 to build a new foundation for our state, repealing the old Michigan business tax, cutting about $1.5 billion worth of spending, actually setting a little money aside in the rainy day fund, cutting a lot, regulations and rules, reforming workman's compensation, unemployment insurance reform, doing a lot of these major big reforms, passing right to work legislation. Mm-hmm. I think as we got in, if it wasn't for term limits, I don't know if we would have gotten all that. And so I think a lot of those reforms, because we weren't worried about the next election, we were worried about the next generation. And I think that's what it is. It always comes down to the individual. How do we worry about that next generation? And how do we leave them in a better place? I appreciated the last year and a half when I've been out of, the back and forth of the state legislature, the governor. It was great. I was my first year of marriage with my wife. We were able to spend, some weekends and evenings mm-hmm. together and build that good foundation with my wife. And that there is a life after politics, which is important to know, because I don't look to Lansing or Washington for my salvation. I look to a higher being, the creator. And so it's something where as I continue to work and fight for the hardworking taxpayers of West Michigan, I want to bring those values to Lansing, not Lansing's values back to us.
Very good. Well, I want to thank you very much for coming in and spending some time with WKTV. We look forward to following the election, and good luck in the primary.
Always a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
You're welcome. This has been WKTV Journal In Focus. I'm Ken Norris. Thanks to our guests, and thanks to you for joining us today. And remember, learn more, get involved.